Namaste. I am Dr. Archana Joshi, a practicing pediatrician from Virar. Today, I will be talking to you about pyrexia of unknown origin. Is the fever during the first 2 to 3 days a PUO? The answer will be a big no. Acute febrile illness, with cause being not apparent, even after careful history and physical examination, and the fever which lasts less than 7 days, could be a self-limiting viral illness in more than 70% of the cases. Or it could be a post-vaccination fever or uncomplicated urinary tract infection, pneumonia, or occult bacteremia. In routine office practice, infection is the most common cause of fever, and the clues to common community-acquired infections are often available within the first 4 days and at times certainly by the end of the first week. For example, these common infections are upper respiratory tract infection, lower respiratory tract infection, urinary tract infection, dysentery, etc. Pyrexia of unknown origin is defined in 1961 as fever more than 100.4 degrees centigrade or 38.3 degrees centigrade lasting more than 3 weeks, with last 1 week in the hospital with several tests ordered to find out the cause of fever. This definition has been evolved since 1961 as more accurate diagnostic techniques are available and 1 week of hospitalization is not necessary nowadays. It is not practical to wait for 3 weeks, and we must attempt to arrive at a provisional diagnosis clinically much before 3 weeks and also plan tests based on the provisional diagnosis. After all, provisional diagnosis is a must before ordering any test. When investigating fever of 1 to 2 weeks, it is important to consider the age of onset, the family history, the travel history, history of exposure to animals, periodicity, associated symptoms, and response to treatment. A careful physical examination during and between febrile episodes may provide useful clues, like evanescent rash at the peak of fever, as in case of systemic onset juvenile idiopathic arthritis, or presence of spleen in case of malaria. All these findings guide laboratory investigations. It is important to rule out the possibility of an infectious disease, the common ones being enteric fever, scrub typhus, malaria, and leptospirosis, which are known to cause prolonged fevers without any localizing signs. Less common infectious diseases like osteomyelitis, arthritis, occult abscesses, or infective endocarditis may show localizing signs and symptoms. Hence, repeated clinical examinations are mandatory, because new signs and symptoms may appear over time, which may give us a clue to the likely diagnosis, and this may help us to choose the appropriate laboratory investigations. When there exists no clues beyond first week, we must look carefully for symptoms of irrationally and partially treated bacterial infections, such as cough to suggest pneumonia, or vomiting irritability to suggest meningitis, or vague abdominal symptoms to suggest typhoid fever or urinary tract infection. Besides this, one must also consider tuberculosis and search for clues in the history, such as loss of appetite, loss of weight, preceding fever, or contact with an open case of tuberculosis. If there is history of abdominal distension indicating probable hepatosplenomegaly or neck swelling, likely to be a lymph node, this may all suggest either disseminated tuberculosis or Epstein-Barr viral infection or brucellosis, in which case patients don't appear sick, but the patients with leukemia appear sick with similar history. History of similar significant pallor or purpuric skin rash would obviously point to hematological illnesses. The presence of high fever every 10 to 12 hours with evanescent skin rash with normal interfebrile period would denote systemic onset of juvenile idiopathic arthritis. In addition, history of mouth ulcers or joint pain and swelling would suggest rheumatological disorders. However, if there are no clues even in the second week of fever, rare diseases need to be considered, such as autoimmune febrile syndromes, hypothalamic tumor, autonomic nervous system disorders, hyperthyroidism, heat fever, drug fever, etc. One must look for accompanying symptoms or clues. For example, in heat fever, the periphery is also equally hot as the central part of the body, and there is very poor response to antipyretics. This is the hallmark of the heat fever. Prolonged fever of more than 2 weeks duration or more weeks poses diagnostic challenges due to the wide variety of differential diagnosis, including the rare infections like malignancies, rheumatological conditions, and other rare causes. Epidemiological data, contact history, previous medical history, fever pattern, focused physical examination, and screening tests often provide adequate information to establish a diagnosis. Non-invasive tests are performed first before taking up the child for any invasive procedure or any expensive investigations in a stepwise manner based on the clinical details. Management includes supportive treatment as well as the targeted therapy after the diagnosis is obtained. Empirical use of broad-spectrum antimicrobials, antimalarials, antituberculous therapy, and use of steroids should be strictly avoided. Parents should maintain a fever diary, a chart fever. They should chart the fever every 4 hourly. They should maintain a travel diary, recall any contact with animals or birds, and they should maintain everything and tell all this to the treating physician. These patients with prolonged fevers have to be counseled very well. These parents are very much worried, and in counseling, we should spend a lot of more time with the parents. We should take a detailed history of onset of fever, response to paracetamol, rhythm of fever, associated symptoms, etc. We should emphasize on the 6 points of fever. How is the onset of fever? How is the interfebrile period? How is the pattern of fever? Is the fever rhythmic or erratic? How is the progress of fever? Is the fever decreasing or it is increasing? Are there any localizing pointers? All this should be asked in detail to the parents. We should counsel the parents, reassure them, and emphasize on the red flag signs. We should tell them about that they should watch for altered sensorium, poor feeding, cold extremities, decreased urine output, and if there is any difficulty in breathing. More attention should be paid to the malnourished and immunocompromised children. Friends, every PO starts on the first day, and we must attempt to diagnose the cause of the fever in first week, and if not, at least in the second week. I am sure group diagnosis, infection or non-infective disorders is possible with such a rational approach and help in further subgroup diagnosis. If we follow all this strictly and rationally, we will be able to diagnose all the cases of PUO and manage them rationally. Thank you.